Several weeks ago, I shared the experience of visiting Africa as an adolescent, where I confronted the horrors of slavery on a visceral level in Ghana, and where I encountered an inexplicable silence on the subject when I returned home to the United States. It was an experience that quickened me. But one of this week's stories got me thinking about another episode in my life, one that causes me pain to remember. I offer it as a means of suggesting that if these stories of the deep north have taken you to some uncomfortable places in your own life, you're not alone. I've been going there too. I offer this story as well as a warning against making any smug judgments about those who came before us and about the moral failures that we perceive in them. Because these are our stories too. Here's mine. I was in seventh grade, living in a college town that was and is predominantly white. That year, a new student was enrolled at the middle school that I attended. She had a kind of old-fashioned name and had, so it seemed, gone through a growth spurt recently, for her clothes were ill-fitting and more than a little worn. She was tall and thin, and walked with an awkward gait, as if she was trying her best to live into a strange new body. The glasses that she wore matched her name. They seemed from a different era. She was shy, withdrawn, and as I recall, kind of sweet. She was also, to my knowledge, the only black child who attended that middle school. She and her family lived in an apartment that I passed as I walked home from school every day. One winter day, after playing video games at the local arcade, I was approaching the apartment unit where she lived, and I saw some older boys throwing snowballs at the side of her house. It was an act of bullying, and a racist one at that. But for some reason, I am ashamed to say, I found it funny. When they had finished pelting the house with their snowballs, they turned and they fled, having left small pockmarks in the vinyl siding. No one emerged to scold them or chase them down. A few days later, I passed the apartment once again, this time with one of my own friends. I shared with him what I had seen. And soon, we too began throwing snowballs at the house, each of them making a noisy thwack against the building. We knew who lived there. And we thought it was funny. To this day, I wonder why I did that. My parents had taught me better. My church had taught me better. My teachers had taught me better. But even so, on that day, as an unaware 11-year-old, I followed a barely concealed script of racial hierarchy and, yes, of white supremacy. I became the one who tormented another child, one who also happened to be the only black child who attended my school. I did that. I don't know if she heard the noise our snowballs made on the side of her house. If she did, I don't know what she might have thought. But as I imagine it now, every noisy thud would have been received as a soul-deadening message, hurled by thoughtless and ignorant children who were, at that moment, allowing a whole culture and a whole history to express itself through their ignorant actions. My ignorant actions. The hot shame I feel when I recall that episode is one of the reasons I so appreciate the story of Paul in the book of Acts. For those of us who may carry such memories, the story indicates that it is possible to grow and to change and to alter one's very being from the inside out with a little help from those around us and perhaps from God. I think we desperately need to remember that story on this Wheels of Justice journey. I think we desperately need to recall that story right now as a country, because it reveals to us that history is not necessarily destiny, and that who we have been is not a reflection of who we may yet be. Paul, you'll remember, had been breathing threats against the disciples of Jesus, and he was, in a fateful instant, knocked off of his horse by a blinding light. And a divine voice spoke from out of that light, asking why Paul had been persecuting not only the disciples, but Jesus himself. Paul, prior to that moment, had been Saul, a Roman citizen, and he possessed all the cultural and the legal privileges that that citizenship implied. I'd like to suggest to you that he was the ancient equivalent of what it now means to be white. But you see, in that moment of revelation, when the voice of one of those who suffered reached him, everything changed for Paul. His name, his identity, his choice of friends, his moral commitments, every last thing. Jesus confronted him as the very voice of the disinherited, the face of those that he had threatened, and in that moment, everything shifted. Jesus comes even to one such as Paul, even to one such as you, even to one such as me. I suspect that many white folks have stories like mine, tucked away somewhere. Okay. If it be so, let us own it. Analogously, I know that many families and many church communities, many towns, many states, many regions are bearers of stories akin to my own. Let us own those too. They are useful reminders that we are not all sweetness and light. They are useful reminders that we must exercise vigilance even against ourselves, lest that part of our souls forces its way into the open. Let those stories make us humble. Let them make us merciful toward those who may be in a different place on these matters because we should be able to see ourselves in them too, at least in part. But let us own this as well. The promise of conversion. The promise of change. The promise of moral growth as delivered in that story of Paul. Let us affirm for ourselves, for our community, for our very country, for our world, that Jesus, or however we structure whatever it is we think of the divine, that Jesus, the divine, is not through with us, and that grace can and does work in our midst. Quite often, it comes as an interruption that knocks us off of our horse. Those are some of the themes that we'll encounter in both of the Deep North stories that we'll share with you today. They're stories of casual cruelty and of the intimidation of children by other children. They're stories of profound courage as well, of prophetic witness, and of necessary interruptions. But I'd like to say that there are also stories about how change does come to occur, and of how cultures can gradually shift, and of how moral growth can and sometimes does take place. For the first of our segments, we'll travel to the town of Canterbury, here in eastern Connecticut, a little bit north of where we are right now. There, Marilyn Nelson will narrate the story of Prudence Crandall and the school that she opened for African-American girls in the 1820s. It's a harrowing tale, but also a story of profound courage. After that, we'll come right back here to our meeting house, which also has a story to tell, where David Good will share a piece of our own congregation's history from that same era. Let's head on up to Canterbury now.
Canterbury, Connecticut, at the house in which Prudence Crandall held a school for girls, which was opened in 1831. And in 1832, underwent a major shift when Prudence Crandall accepted one African-American girl as a student in the school. This was in the fall of 1832. And this young woman was working as a servant in one of the other houses in Canterbury. And Prudence Crandall, who was a Quaker, educated in the Quaker schools, and a radical. She had a short haircut, for example, in 1830. Decided to take the tremendous step of allowing this girl to take classes at her school. The result of that made Prudence Crandall the state heroine of Connecticut, and entered her into a wonderful, although difficult, place in history books. Prudence Crandall, who opened Miss Crandall's school for young ladies and little misses of color. Her revolutionary act.
When she accepted this young woman, whose name was Mariah Davis, and the townspeople responded negatively, they wanted the school closed unless Mariah Davis was expelled. Prudence Crandall did close the school, but she took out ads in abolitionist newspapers announcing that she was opening a school for young women of color. And young women came from up and down the Eastern Seaboard to enroll in Prudence Crandall's school. And when this happened, the state of Connecticut passed a law forbidding the opening of such a school. Prudence Crandall was found guilty of breaking this law. She spent a couple of days in jail. She was put on trial. She managed to keep the school going for a few months, not even a year, but a few months, educating the girls who had come from Rhode Island, New York, New Jersey. Free girls who wanted to be educated because they wanted to teach. And then finally her neighbors, after poisoning the well, refusing to sell provisions, harassing the girls, finally set the building on fire. And at that point, Prudence Crandall decided that she could not keep the school open because it was too dangerous for the girls. She closed the school and left town. I'm going to read the names of the girls who were students here in 1832 and 1833.
These are the names of the students of Miss Crandall's school for young ladies and little misses of color. Henrietta Bolt, Elizabeth Douglas Bustill, M. E. Carter, Jerusha Congdon, Mariah Davis, Theodosia DeGrasse, Amy Fenner, Polly Freeman, Eliza Glasgow, Anne Eliza Hammond, Sarah Lloyd Hammond, Mary Harris, Sarah Harris, Elizabeth Henley, J.K. Johnson, Harriet Lanson, Ann Peterson, Mariah Robinson, Elizabeth Smith, Catherine Ann Weldon, Eliza Weldon, Ann Elizabeth Wilder, Julia Williams, Amelia Wilson. These were girls who were students at Prudence Crandall School. They ranged in age from 12 to about 18. They came here alone in stagecoaches from wherever it was they were living with their families. They arrived here in Canterbury, Connecticut, in search of an education that would make it possible for them to educate other African Americans in other places in the United States. Again, this was the 1830s. This was 35 years before emancipation. This is a poem. This book, Miss Crandall's School for Young Ladies and Little Misses of Color, it was co-authored by Elizabeth Alexander and myself. Each of us wrote a dozen sonnets for it. I'm going to read a sonnet by Elizabeth Alexander, which describes one of the experiences these girls lived with during this time. It's called Cat. Eliza finds the black and white striped cat tethered to the front gate with its throat slit. At first, she considers telling no one, finding Frederick's shovel and burying the poor dead wretch in a backyard corner. As her classmates, she has learned to handle what comes as worse and worse comes, like teacher and every person she has ever known, to keep her hand to the plow, eyes to God. Today, though, this stiff, splayed creature, open-eyed, spilling viscera, is more than Eliza can handle by herself. She runs inside, screams the news. Eliza is 12 years old. The cat is black and white.
Good morning. I'd like to thank Steve for leading us in this Wheels of Justice journey. It's been a difficult journey as we journey back in time to explore the roots of systemic racism here in our own community, but a very important one. It reminds me of after apartheid in South Africa, the important process of truth and reconciliation, that it was a time for them to say, if we're going to be able to go forward as a country, we need to acknowledge the truth of what has transpired during the days of apartheid. And so I think every town in our country ought to be going through the same process, that in order to have reconciliation, to have the kind of country we want, we've got to confront the truth, the good and the bad of our history and our country. I'm reminded of one of the lines of one of my favorite poems by T.S. Eliot from The Four Quartets, where he said, "The way forward is the way back." And it also reminds me of the dilemma that all of us sometimes find ourselves in the season of winter, where we're stuck in the ice or in a snowdrift. Sometimes the only way to go forward is by throwing the car into reverse and then going forward once again. And as I see it, our country is very much a soul on ice at the moment, as we struggle to find our way out of the current problems that we have, the number of black people, male and female, who have been killed by police brutality, as we look at what happened on January 6th in our nation's capital with the rise of white supremacy in our country and the outburst of that on January the 6th. And clearly we're a country, a soul on ice. And so it's good for us to go in reverse and to explore the painful part of our past so that we can hopefully go future, toward the future for a better tomorrow. Remembering also that there's no healing without remembrance. So here we are. We're now in the fifth meeting house, and I'd like to remind everyone that this is the meeting house. It's not the church. The church is the people, and this is the fifth of our meeting houses. This happens to be the place where we worship and gather for various meetings and worship services. But the church is the people, and so I like to think of the meeting house as having a foundation, but the church. It's good to have the church on wheels. Wheels of justice as we explore the various aspects of the human family and our struggle for a better future. So this is our fifth meeting house, but the story for today actually comes from the fourth meeting house that was built in 1817 and was destroyed by fire in 1907. I hope you can see the trim on our pews. And also on our communion table. This is called African mahogany. African mahogany. Now, this is in the fifth meeting house. I don't know if they would have had the same kind of wood in the fourth meeting house. But in the fifth meeting house, they were quite deliberate to make sure that the wood that we had for the trim was from Africa. So think about that. Hold that thought for a moment. So here we are up in the corner of the balcony. And this is where black people, the descendants of slaves, were required to sit during the worship services. So think about that, African mahogany for the fifth meeting house, but in the previous meeting house, the descendants of slaves were required to sit here. And some even use the word, the N-word, for the black people that would sit up in this area. So clearly here is an indication of segregation with the black people here and the white people sitting elsewhere in the meeting house. And I'd like to share with you one story of one of those black people that would have sat in these pews. And her name was Nancy Freeman. Sometime early in my ministry, I came across in our church history, in our files for church history, I came across an envelope that said, on the outside of that envelope, admonition of Nancy, a colored woman. Admonition of Nancy, a colored woman. It makes me wonder, I wondered at the time if perhaps there had been other admonitions. I'm sure there were. And I wonder if they always had that same kind of qualifier. For example, I wonder if there might have been an admonition to David, a white person. But this was admonition of Nancy, a colored person. The year was 1830, and on May the 6th, the minister of the church, the Reverend Chester Colton, received a letter from a church member saying that Nancy, a woman of color, had been guilty of conduct which is contrary to the rules and regulations of the gospel of Christ, saying she didn't come to church, neglected receiving Holy Communion, and was frequently intoxicated. On the very next day, Reverend Colton sent a letter to Nancy to tell her that she would have to appear before a congregational meeting to hear the charges against her. And on May the 31st, 1830, the same year, Nancy was excommunicated from our church. And Jesus wept. That's the shortest verse in the entire Bible. And Jesus wept. I would often put that envelope on my desk as a reminder of this sad, sad chapter in our church's history. Admonition of Nancy, a colored woman. Perhaps it requires another admonition. Admonition of a church in Old Lyme to learn what it means to practice radical hospitality. Let's now go downstairs for another story. I arrived in the summer of 1973 as a seminarian, and I had the privilege and honor of getting to know one of my predecessors, the William Dixon Hoag, one of our previous ministers. As he was nearly blind, I would often read to him, and he shared the story of how when he first came to Old Lyme, he quoted Mahatma Gandhi so often he came to be known affectionately as the Gandhi Kid. Remember, it was Gandhi who said, "You must be the change you wish to see for the world." Dick was a chaplain at the Nyanic prison for women, where he would smuggle cigarettes into the inmates. Grace can come in peculiar ways. He would frequently invite black prisoners to a worship service and gave them a place of honor up in our pulpit area. Not pews in the back in the balcony, but right up in the front. Also, I learned how during his ministry, a black woman would come to church with her face covered in white, maybe white shoe polish. Tragic that she might think that she would have to have a white face in order to be respectable or acceptable enough to be a part of this house of prayer. Maybe she was mentally ill. Maybe she was a victim of discrimination. Maybe she was a Latter-day Nancy suffering from discrimination. I don't know. While others may have wanted to have her seated way in the back upstairs, Dick, God bless him, insisted that she have a seat of honor right in the front. Behind me is her welcome statement, with olive wood pineapples on either side, a symbol of hospitality. And I hope that the wood, olive wood that comes from the Holy Land, from the land of Palestine, might remind us of the teachings of Jesus. For our annual Tree of Life journeys to the Holy Land, I love to gather around underneath a beautiful tree overlooking the Sea of Galilee, where Jesus would have offered his Sermon on the Mount, not in a building, not with a lot of ecclesiastical furniture, but rather out in the open under a tree. This for me is always an opportunity to remember the authentic Jesus. The Jesus that cannot be recognized in the institution of slavery, apartheid, Jim Crow, systematic racism, the cruel rules and regulations of a church, or the horrible excommunication of people like Nancy. It's an opportunity to remember those beautiful words of his, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." And my house should be called a house of prayer for all people. What a beautiful word that little word all is, A-L-L. And that's enough for me. It's enough for me to fall in love with the authentic Jesus. So we have African mahogany, and we have olive wood from the Holy Land. The best way to respond to our tragic history of complicity in slavery and racism is to reaffirm our commitment to the authentic Jesus and the radical love and radical hospitality he exemplified.
By way of conclusion, I'd like to offer a short coda to David's stories about the segregated pews that existed within our meeting house right here, and the excommunication of Nancy. After the fire that burned the previous meeting house down in 1907, this particular structure that we're now standing in was built in its place, a near identical replica. And it was dedicated, as David told us, in 1910. Upon the occasion of that dedication, Woodrow Wilson, then the president of Princeton University, soon to be president of the United States, ascended to this pulpit, and he offered an address to the community. Whatever his intellectual and political gifts, Wilson also happened to be a strident racist and an ardent segregationist. He was, however, evidently quite at home here in the Limes, for this is where he summered. When other Ivy League institutions were actively seeking to enroll African American students, Wilson, then as president of Princeton University, was working to keep them out. A little later, while in the White House, he screened the film The Birth of a Nation, which celebrates the formation of the KKK. The film approvingly cites Wilson himself in one of its title cards, and it is widely credited as actively reviving the Klan, which until that moment had been all but defunct. More troubling still, Wilson went on to preside over a strict segregation of the federal government, where federal buildings were equipped with barriers separating workstations, and where separate bathrooms and dining areas were imposed in federal buildings that up until that point had not experienced that kind of segregation. Here's an irony, or maybe not an irony. Wilson was a preacher's kid, and he had grown up in Virginia listening to his father give sermons, sermons which also happened to extol the virtues of the South and of slavery. And so it comes as one more painful truth that we must contend with here in the deep North, that this very meeting house was blessed and was dedicated by an ardent segregationist. Poor Woodrow Wilson. If only he could have recognized the irony that confronted him when he spoke on that day in 1910. The congregation that day sat in pews adorned by Africa, African mahogany, each and every one of them. The communion table right behind me here, this last vestige that Protestant churches retain of an altar, that too was and is constructed of African wood. It is, if I may say so, a secret African altar placed immediately beneath the location from which Woodrow Wilson would have spoken. But the greatest irony of all would have been the ascent that Wilson made in order to access the pulpit. Those steps, these here, right there, were also born in Africa. They too are made of African wood. And so in order to speak to the community gathered in 1910, Wilson would have needed to ascend upon Africa. He was, along with everyone gathered on that day, adorned by, in communion with, and elevated by Africa. A truth that continues to this day. We are all adorned by, in communion with, and elevated by Africa. Poor Woodrow Wilson. But it's a happy occasion for us. Is that not the secret history of the deep north? Is that not the secret history of Old Lyme itself? And is that not the secret history of the First Congregational Church of Old Lyme? Look, that secret has been out with regard to the United States as a whole, but it's one that needs to be spoken aloud in this particular setting. Because whether we recognize it or not, this community has always been shaped by proximity to Africa, even if that knowledge has remained deeply buried. Our task is to continue to speak that secret openly and to not let it be forgotten. Our task is to tell the truth of who we have been, trusting that in speaking the truth, such a thing as reconciliation can and will emerge. But look, this also is true. It's not 1910 anymore. And I'm no longer 11 years old. Growth occurs. In our context, an awful lot has happened in the last 111 years. Thank God we're not who we were. Thanks to the courageous leadership of those like Dick Hoag. Thanks to the courageous leadership of those like David Good. And thanks to the leadership of countless members of this community who have pushed and prodded to bring us ever closer to the spirit of the authentic Jesus, the voice of the disinherited. We're not who we were, and for that we can give thanks. Even so, we can still strive to become more. We'll close this week with a song from the Neville Brothers. It's a song entitled My Blood. And it comes from one of my favorite albums of all time called Yellow Moon. Each verse names a part of the world that we have been privileged to be in relation with over the last decades. Africa, Haiti, the reservation in South Dakota. The song prays for God's blessings to fall upon those lands and those peoples. And it makes a profound affirmation. That's my blood down there, the Nevilles sing. As the song plays, you'll see images from all of our partnerships displayed on your screens. And what I hope is that it leads you to a bold affirmation of your own. One in which you're able to say, that's my blood down there too. For we are all a part of the same human family. In need of care. In need of tender mercy. In need of healing. In need of justice. In need of love. Amen.
Mother.